prepared.
Good morning. Please join me in welcoming a trio of U.S. Women's Open champions, Hilary Lunke, Karrie Webb, and Juli Inkster. Thanks so much for being here. I'm going to start with each of you. Just a brief kind of overview and comment on the reunion this week. I know some of us weren't in the room the other night, and we've heard some good stories already, but what it means to be here and a little bit about the dinner the other night. I'll start with Hilary.
Yeah, it's the dream continues for me, I guess. I still pinch myself that I'm even a part of all of this, but these are the kind of times my normal life right now bears very little resemblance to being a U.S. Open champion. So these are the times when you come and kind of realize the gravity of what took place 20 years ago for me, and just to be a part of this league of women is an honor and a privilege. It's just been dreamy, really.
Karrie.
It's been a fantastic few days. The dinner the other night was really special to have 39 past champions in the room and hearing all the different stories and really catching up with a lot of people. I haven't seen Hilary for many years, so, just catching up with people you haven't seen and realizing that we're, a very special fraternity of players that, that have been fortunate enough to win the biggest tournament in golf.
Juli?
Well, I've been overserved every night, so that's kind of been... I'm going to go home and detox for the next week. But it's been great. I mean, it took me so long to win a U.S. Open. And then, all the... you're reaping the awards afterwards. And, just to be... I've played the last couple of days with Webby, and, we text and stuff, but we don't really ever get, to have a time to really sit down and talk. And I sat next to Hilary at lunch at Cyprus yesterday and had an amazing grilled cheese sandwich with French fries. So the USGA has done a great job, and to bring us all back together and be as a group and being able to do these special things together, it really means a lot.
Hilary, you mentioned a 20 years big anniversary. What's it been like kind of reliving it because of this milestone anniversary and maybe sharing your Women's Open story with people who might not be as familiar with it?
Yeah, it has kind of been neat to relive it in a lot of ways and to be prompted to remember parts about it that I thought maybe I would have had forgotten and realized that the memories are still in there. So, I think as Juli mentioned, when you're standing over those putts, you're not thinking that 20 years from now you're still going to be reaping the benefits of whether or not this ball goes in the hole. And it's times like this that you realize just kind of all that goes along with being a Women's Open champion. So it's been fun. It's been a great trip down memory lane for me and just a reminder of just what a special... really special time in my life that was and how much I can still so vividly remember. In some ways it feels like it happened last week, and then you go play Cyprus yesterday and reminded I can barely break 80 now. So in that sense, it's a good reminder. It was definitely 20 plus years ago.
We'll open it up for questions. Joey has a mic here if you raise your hand. And Karrie, just one more for you. Minji reminded us that you reminded her that you were the last one to win back-to-back. But I know last year was extra special for you watching her do what she did at Pine Needles. What has that relationship been like?
It's a special relationship. All of the girls that come through my scholarship program, I have a really good bond with. But I've known Minji since she was about 13 or 14. So, I've watched her grow into, just a wonderful person that she is now and obviously one of the best players in the world. But obviously watching her win last year and to be able to walk down 18 like I was able to do in 2001, knowing that you're going to win the U.S. Open, it was really cool for me to see her do that.
Where is it? I don't think we heard any great stories, actually, from Monday. What can you share about the best stories, and who would you say were the best storytellers, at least in the sober division?
I don't know. We definitely have... no one is a short storyteller, I think. There was a lot of long-winded stories that went on tangents that had nothing to do with winning the U.S. Open.
and
yeah. And so much so that I don't think we got through all the past champions in the room getting to speak. But I think one of the special stories was Sari Pack was trying to avoid speaking, and I think everyone in the room, you know, I think there was at least 10 or 11 South Korean players as past champions in the room, and I think everyone in the room knew that that Sari needed to speak and talk about, you know, being the trailblazer that she was. So I think it was really cool to hear her speak.
Mm-hmm. Ron?
I can't remember. you've all been around for a while. What's it mean for the women's game, the increase in prize money that this event's had and the upgrade in venues that it's had to be in an iconic place like this? That's what it means in terms of growing the game and the respect for the game.
Oh, I think it's huge. You know, I would have loved to be able to play U.S. Open at Pebble Beach and, you know, being from this area. But I think the women deserve this, to be able to play these iconic golf courses and have their games challenged just like the men. And, you know, playing Pebble Beach, the history that has come through here on the men's side, you know, with Tom Watson chipping in and Nicklaus and Tiger, and it's going to be great to have a woman have those memories also.
Mm-hmm. Anything to add from the?
You got anything to add?
Oh, me.
Yeah.
thought it was Hilary standing up. I agree with Julie. I think, you know, I obviously would have loved to have played a U.S. Open here, but you know, the fact that it's happening, you know, it's you know, it's better than it not happening, and it is on the rotation now. And you know, I think when casual viewers of golf tune in and see that the U.S. Women's Open's at Pebble Beach, it's like, oh, this is something I need to pay attention to, because every, you know, even the casual sports or golf fan knows Pebble Beach. And so the fact that we're, you know, the girls are on stage on this iconic venue. I just looked at the weather forecast for the weekend, and I'm actually glad I'm not playing. I think it's going to, I'll just have some popcorn and watch it on TV.
Yeah. I'm right there with you, buddy.
But yeah, I think it'll be great just to see how it unfolds, and I think Pebble Beach will do what it's always done, and you know, one of the best players in the world will be on top at the end of the week.
Mm-hmm. We have one here from the WebEx. The last three majors have been won by women 25 and younger, certainly a youth movement. What does it mean kind of for the future of the game or the health of the game right now to see those young players succeeding?
Mm-hmm. I just answered. You can
go. Well, I think I was 23 or 24 when I won the Open too, so I can, I guess, sort of speak to that, although it was my only win, so... but I think that it's fantastic for the game, and it's exciting to see that there's so many fantastic young players. Every time I come out here, I'm just amazed, actually, at the depth of talent now compared to when I was playing in college and high school golf. You know, there's just you know, dozens and dozens of these outstanding players that are going to be featured this week. So I think it's great. I did a little clinic on earlier this week for the first tee, and just seeing so many girls get involved in the game, I think it's awesome. When I was playing, you know, there were college scholarships that were going unused because there just weren't enough girls even interested in the game. And so I think it's awesome, and it's just going to be all the better for women's sports.
Julie is probably our local expert. Talk a little bit about the golf course and what does it take to win here?
Well, I think this is what's great about Pebble is from the first tee to the 18th tee, you can get a lot of different weather changes, a lot of different, you know, get out in the ocean and the wind's blowing, and then you come in and it's not blowing. I think it challenges you all aspects of your game: chipping, putting, driving. You use all the clubs in your bag, which I think is a great representation of a championship. You're going to have a lot of 3 and 4 and 5 footers on these poa greens that can grow rapidly during the afternoon. Mm-hmm. And that's going to test your nerves, but you know, I think you know, it's pretty generous off the tee, but you have to be really precise with your iron game. You know, they're small greens, and you got to be on below the hole. You know, you can have a 4-footer right to left, and it's going to break, you know, 6 to 8 inches. So I think a good iron player, and I do think, once again, I think if you got to play the par fives, like you got to get to number two and number six. You know, those are birdie holes. You got to be ready to play when you start on one, because, you know, one through – four, you know, you need to make some birdies because you got to just hang on that backside.
Mm-hmm. Doug?
I'd be curious what how you guys perceive the attention women's golf is getting right now in an era where it feels like corporates are starting to wake up and share the wealth, if you will. Do you think the LPGA is getting enough eyeballs? And if not, why not?
Well, you know, I think we're getting more eyeballs as far as corporations, but you know, we still make maybe 10% of what the guys make, so we're not really even close to what the guys make, especially the lower level tier players. You know, the 100th and 105th player. I mean, a lot of these girls, you know, finish, you know, the 100th best woman in the world, and they got to get a part-time job. So I don't think that's right, but yeah, I mean, we were talking about you know, how much we made in, and I think Webby, would you say you made in 2000?
Well, I said that, yeah. When Minji won last year, I had two seasons that I made more than that, and I won 7 times and 6 times. So yeah, but I also think that, you know, when I won in 2001, I was the largest check a woman had ever made, which was $500,000, and you know, players of eras before me that were no longer playing were saying sort of the same. It was the same story, and yeah. I feel like if the next generation isn't playing for more money, then we've failed during our time. So
exactly,
you know, I think it's fantastic that the girls are, you know, I think these checks are. I mean, $500,000 was life changing for me, but I feel like this week, $2 million. I mean, that is seriously life-changing money. And, you know, I think the girls deserve it, you know. And it's great that the majors have been elevated to this standard.
I mean, these ladies work extremely hard. Mm-hmm. You know, they travel commercial. They rent cars. They, you know, stay in private housing. I mean, it's a lot of work to be on the LPGA, and I'm, as Karrie said, if, you know, if they were playing for the same money, we kind of failed as growing the game, and hopefully they will keep growing the game, because that's the only way that we're going to get to where we need to be.
Mm-hmm. Ron?
You know, we're talking about the tours getting younger and younger, and particularly Webby and Julie. What advice do you give to those young players to have a long career? I mean, you both had, Julie, I think the first time you told me you were retiring was 22 years ago.
And then she just stopped showing up. She actually never retired.
Yeah.
But what's your tip to them to have a long career?
Well, I personally think that you got to have outside interests. It can't be golf 24/7, and I see a lot of these players out here. It's golf 24/7. You know, I didn't start till I was 15. I played a lot of different sports, had a lot of outside interests. You know, when I went home, I hung them up, and I think a lot of these girls don't know how to do that. But if like, you know, with my Inkster Award winners, I try to tell them that, you know, it's not all about golf. You got to rest your body. You got to rest your mind. You know, you got to find some outside interests. And it's hard for these young ladies that are coming up to get involved, because a lot of them haven't been to college. A lot of them don't have, like, friends outside golf. You know, they're very mature golf-wise, but they really haven't learned how to live outside of the golf world, and that's what I try to get my Inkster Awards to do.
Kent.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. Building off of Doug's question earlier, we've seen in women's tennis, they've caught up to the men in purse. We've seen national women's soccer catch up and surpass men's soccer in ratings. We just mentioned the venue, the purse. What piece of the pie is missing for women's golf to not catch up to men's golf?
Well, I can't believe I can answer all these questions.
You're the resident expert on this?
I do think I would love to see a little more emotion out on the golf course, a little more passion, a little more, you know, you could tell when Webby was five over or five under, and you could tell the same with me. I think a lot of these ladies out here, and you can't tell that, which is not right or wrong. That's just kind of the way they were brought up. But I would like when I'm watching TV, I like to see people, you know, get fired up. And so I think, you know, maybe show a little more emotion out there.
I think it's more to do with our broadcast itself. On a week-to-week basis, the LPGA is paying. We're paying to be on TV. So when you're versus for the PGA Tour, TV stations are, you know, are paying millions of dollars per week. So I just feel like if we're paying for it, they can cut costs and not put on a great production because they don't have to, you know. They're getting paid for that. Whereas when they're paying to do it, they want to be the best production they possibly can, so more eyeballs watch it. And I think the television partners need to be as excited about women's golf as some of these big corporations are. You know, they're seeing the value in women's golf, and then putting their money where their mouth is. And I really feel like our broadcast partners really need to partner with us to lift us to where we should be.
And also, I mean, I think the data, you know, when you watch a men's tournament, they have stats that are, you know, on the TV screen. They have ball tracer, you know, and I find that super entertaining to see, you know, where the ball's flying to, or, you know, how many putts they made from 5 feet and under for the week, or 10 feet and under for the week, or what's their ball speed? What are they carrying it? And we don't have the LPGA does not have any of that, which I think really lifts the viewership when they can, you know, we're kind of in a data era right now, and I think the more stats you can throw out there on television, I think it makes it interesting for the average golfer who wants to try to be, you know, good.
You know, Julie, since you're the most mature, but that doesn't really qualify at this point, but the most experienced.
No one's ever said I'm mature, that's for sure.
One of the great things, I think anyway, about this organization is it's been on its own since 1950 with no outside help whatsoever, mm-hmm. and look what you're playing for now. Would you have liked to have seen any help, and I'm not sure you guys ever asked for it, from the PGA Tour, just in terms of marketing and showcasing, could they be help? Could they have been help years ago, and do you think it's worth looking at now?
That's, you know, it's kind of a loaded question on, yes, I think we could have used some help. It just with, you know, TV and media. But on the other hand, I think it's pretty cool that, you know, we're an organization that has stood by themselves, and believe me, it hasn't been easy. I mean, you know, we've never really had a nest egg to rely on, and you know, now that we're building, and we do. But I think the PGA and the LPGA could work better together, and I think Jay and Molly have done a good job where they are working more together. Not only them, but you know, with PGA of America, with Seth and the RNA. I mean, I think they are trying to help the LPGA. And, I think, you know, the game of golf reaches all boundaries. And to have men and women, you know, competing with each other and for each other, I think it just grows the game, and I think it's something that needs to be needed more.
I don't have anything to add.
Yeah. Well, thank you for being here today and this week in general. One more, Doug.
To go back to
he's not out here very much. So
Julie's
got
to go to
Julie's got to go to
Golf Channel.
All right, just a quick golf golf question from your point of view. Do you make a more lasting memory of winning a U.S. Open based on who you beat or where you win? What do you think carries more punch?
I think means a lot. You know, I could care less where I won the U.S. Open. I just wanted to win the U.S. Open, you know. But if I could say I won the U.S. Open at Pebble Beach or Oakmont or Pine Needles or Prairie Dunes or Pumpkin Ridge, you know, being an American, winning your national championship, I mean, if they said we're playing the Open at the Hay, I would have showed up. And so having your name engraved on that trophy, I would go anywhere to play.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, go ahead, Hilary. You haven't talked for a while.
Well, I think in my particular finish, I definitely would say, you know, having Annika bogey the 72nd hole is pretty memorable. It's actually watching the coverage for the first time ever the other night and like, how did she not win? I can't believe it, you know, watching it now. Because you're not thinking about that when you're out there playing. You're just playing the golf course. You're not necessarily thinking about what everybody else is doing. But making that final putt against Angela, I saw her last night actually for the first time in a long time. And that's definitely the memory for me. And like Julie said, you know, you'll show up wherever they say to play for the U.S. Open, and the course isn't necessarily going to be the biggest and best memory of that week. But for me, just the way that my particular championship ended, definitely sharing that experience with Kelly Robbins and Angela Stanford is what I take away from it.
Yeah, I would agree with both. I think, you know, winning at it. Yeah, I think so. But I felt like, though, I still had battles on Sunday with two of the greats of the game, Meg Mallon at the Merritt Club and Sari Pack at Pine Needles. You know, it really wasn't till midway through the back nine at the Merritt Club that I really had control of that tournament. And, you know, I really didn't feel like I had it in the bag until I made birdie on 17. And even then, it put me seven ahead. But I just felt like Pine Needles wasn't a course you could, you know, take your foot off the pedal. So, you know, I feel like I had two Sunday battles with two of the greats of the game. And I think that's just as memorable to me as where I played.
Mm-hmm. I can't remember who I beat. I know. I'm kidding.
I can remember
the other one.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks.